I'm going to be talking today about electrolysis for energy storage, and I'm very excited to work in the field of energy. If you think of one field that really covers basically everything else, whether it's geopolitics or economics or how we decide to power ourselves around our democracy, how we weigh the pros and cons of economics versus environment, what countries become more powerful. It all really comes to energy plays such a large role. So a quick summary of the talk here for the role of electrolysis in renewable energy. First of all, I should mention, I talk about this a little bit later, but electrolysis is quite simply, I'm sure you've all done the experiment, hopefully in your general chemistry class at some point, where you take a couple of wires and you put it in salt water, and hydrogen comes off one side and oxygen comes off the other side. That, in short, is electrolysis. And most of you have probably heard about fuel cell cars. That's just doing the direct opposite. You take the oxygen, you take the hydrogen, they combine together, and you get electricity, which then of course can power a car or a light bulb or whatever. So the summary here, we need renewable energy. I'm gonna talk about that need first. That's usually not a very hard sell these days, but they are becoming much more affordable. And I've seen that occur tremendously even over the past 5 or 10 years. I think people have heard a lot about that. You know, the price of windmills and photovoltaics have really come down quite a bit. But of course, the biggest problem with renewable energy is, of course, it's not always on when you want it. The wind actually blows the hardest on average at about 2 o'clock in the morning, which is exactly the trough of when we need the energy. So there's a maximum amount of energy that you can get from solar or wind unless you find a way to store it. So storage is a big problem. Finally, I'll talk about what we're trying to do with electrolyzers to make this a viable way to store energy. So I like a couple of these slides here. The first one here, I always find a kind of contradictory. A lot of times, the number one impediment to implementing windmills actually comes from the environmentalists. You know, there's always a reason not to do something. If you put up a windmill, you know, of course, that does happen occasionally, but more than often, that's what happens. I mean, but you know, the odds and probability, but if you look at the number of birds that are killed by windmills, it's a very small percentage than the numbers that run into buildings. So, you know, there are choices, and as I said, in the energy field, there are choices that really have to be made. Our former senator from Massachusetts was really good at keeping the windmill out of his backyard, of course, at Cape Wind. Okay, more along the lines of the need for renewable energy, I love this chart. It's not my chart, but if you're a scientist or if you ever studied the presentation of data, this breaks so many rules. It's wonderful. So people talk about peak oil, and peak oil is just the point at the point in time where we produce as much oil, the highest amount at a point in time. We start to, you know, originally in the 1900s, we start to discover the oil, and then we find more uses for it. So we find it in more places, but then it becomes harder and harder to find. Now, it's a huge controversy. If we're at the peak right now, if we've gone beyond the peak, if the peak's going to be in 5 or 10 years, but if you make the axis large enough, nobody can argue about the where the point is right there. But what we can argue about, if it's in 5 years or 10 years down the line, we're certainly very close to the peak. And when I started to study peak oil, this person should be a lot more famous, I think, than he is. This is known as the Hubbert curve. And back in 1956, this is what oil production had done here. And he started to take a look at how resources were found and how they were exploited and how that led to new discoveries as well. But then eventually you run out. So in 1956, looking at just this part of the curve, he predicted what oil consumption and finding and production would look like. And as you see, you know, he predicted a peak at around 2005, 2006. And if you see what actually happened, you know, this is, of course, this is what he was looking at then. This is what has actually happened so far. And what this chart shows as well is for most of the places in the world, their production in fossil fuels is already going down. The state of Texas and the United States as a whole, we reached our peak oil around 1970. And even though, of course, everybody hears about all the new discoveries in North Dakota and Texas and such, this will come up again, but we'll never hit our levels in 1970. Why is that? What are the possible causes? Well, it should be very obvious after taking a look at this chart why oil production is going down. If you see the U.S. crude field and the songs in the top 50, it all has to do with the music. So I think music qualities have been going up since 2010, and that's led to another just nonsense. But it does bring up the point, and I think the cartoon here tells it the best. I don't know if you can read it there in back, but there's the guy here saying, buffalo shortage? What buffalo shortage? Give me enough money for guns and scouts and I'll get you all the buffalo you need. You know, for a long time, the argument for oil has always been, well, if we search hard enough, we'll always find more. And, you know, during the oil embargo period here, you can see the price of oil went way up. So the amount of rigs that we sent out to search for it went up, 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 and up, but then they stopped finding oil. And so they gave up because it didn't make economic sense anymore. The price has gone up again, and we're starting to search some more, but there's only so much that you can do. And here, as you see here, these are all discoveries of oil since 1930, and as you can see, through the 50s, 60s, and 70s, we were always finding a lot more oil than we were using. But since about 1980 was about the last year where we found more oil than we used. So, you know, for those of you that have had your first year of calculus, you can see when the area under this curve is the same area as the area under this curve, that's when we're in big trouble. So I want to talk about why solar and particularly wind is becoming more of a viable option. And if I would have had this talk a few years ago, maybe it would have been a harder, more convincing sell. But now you turn around and there's just a ton of photovoltaics going up. And if you drive across the country, which I have the pleasure to do from time to time, particularly through my old stomping grounds of the Midwest, you can't drive through a prairie or an open ground where it's not populated by windmills. So wind is a lot cheaper. The wind is a pretty mature technology, actually, and the costs are not really coming down anymore. Okay, so we need renewable energies, and they're becoming affordable, so why aren't we using them all the time? And of course, the big problem, intermittency. This is the output of wind in terms of megawatts for the area of Westphalia, Germany, as a function of the date. So you can see the variability is huge, and if you saw the timing on this as well, again, quite often these peaks occur at around 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, so that's the exact opposite time of wind you would choose them, okay? So how can we take the energy and store it? By far, the best way, the most efficient, and the cheapest way to store energy on a large scale is by pumping water up a hill. It's as old as Ma and Pa Ingalls' lumber mill. You block up the dam, and then you open it up when you need the energy. So here's here is the largest hydro station in the area of Germany. This used to be the top of a mountain, and I remember the first time that I saw a picture of this facility, it was given by a German instructor. He was talking about how difficult that it was to build this, and I remember him saying that we Germans prefer our mountains pointy, because it's essentially what you have to do. You have to take a mountain and you have to make it flat and turn it into a lake. So here you have a giant lake, and what you don't see, I think I have it in a picture in a little bit, is there's another lake, say a 1,000 yards below it, and you pump the water up and the water comes down and you pump it up and down. And it's the cheapest way to do it, and it has a very good round trip efficiency. Of course, there's no pump is 100% efficient, so you lose some energy pumping it up, and you don't get all that energy coming back down, but the round trip is around 75 or 80%, and electrical pumps are actually pretty cheap. But if you see, this is how much energy that you can store. It's not even close to being able to handle any of this load, and this is just a small area of Germany, okay? So what's another method that's often proposed for energy storage is compressed air energy storage. If you have an existing natural gas power plant, they can operate much more efficiently under pressurized conditions. So you can greatly increase the efficiency of your existing power plant if you take the excess when it's cheap and you compress the air into the cavern, and then when you need the energy, or a boost, if you will, you blast that excess air into the power plant. You can only do it where there's already a natural gas plant. You still have the natural gas plant, and the natural gas plant has to be located where you have one of these great large underground type of a cavern structure, okay? So the, but now, what if we were to take that same structure and fill it with hydrogen of the same pressure? What could that do? And again, as you see here, that cavern could hold that 600 gigawatt hours of energy. As you see, that one cavern at one facility could cover that entire area of Germany. A couple of the other technologies that are being proposed are, this is a vanadium redox type of a battery. It's very similar to a fuel cell. It's kind of like a battery, but you put all the chemicals in a giant container. All the oxidation species are in one container, and all the reduction species are in the other. And oxidation, reduction, your mind's cranking, but then you spin them around inside of a cell, and so it's very, very much like a battery. But if you use all the vanadium that was produced last year, that's how much it would take to do that. People in UC, it's still, people will propose that, well, why don't we just store all the energy inside of a battery? Well, that's how much energy is stored in the largest battery in the world, and you can see this, and I don't know if you can quite tell the scale of it, but this is the building here, so, you know, a person would be, you know, one pixel there, and so that's the largest sodium sulfur battery made to date. And not to mention, sodium sulfur, it's the, it's, if there's two things that are easier or cheaper to mine in the world than sodium and sulfur, I don't know what they are. They're basically as cheap as dirt. But to use the battery like this, the sodium sulfur battery only works at about 200 degrees C. So each of these plants here, which is about the size of, not quite the size of the building that we're in here, is kept at 200 degrees centigrade all the time. So that's not the easiest thing to do. And here again is I think a beautiful case of pumped hydro. But again, you can quickly imagine there's only so many places like this in the world where you have a natural elevation and a natural lake below where you can easily pump that water up and down. All right. Okay. So I know I've convinced you that, you know, we need renewable energy and that they're more affordable and that. Storage is a big problem. And electrolysis is one of the fuel alternatives. And I'll tell you that, you know, I'm an electrolyzer guy. I've been working in fuel cells since I was, for half of my life now. You know, they always say, if your only tool is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. You know, so I have that bias. So just to tell you that going in, but the experiment that most people have probably done at one time or another, the hydrogen, well, of course, will come off one side, and the oxygen comes off of the other. And this is the in the experiment that you might do in the laboratory. You might just put a porous piece of glass here, or something like that, and that's to stop, of course, the oxygen from coming to the hydrogen side, or the hydrogen side from getting to the oxygen side. The water is literally, you have the positive side and the negative side there, and you put a voltage across it so that the, you know, oxygen's a polar molecule, and it literally rips the molecule right in, not in half, two-thirds, one-third, whatever. But, you know, again, yeah, the hydrogen goes off here. And the diaphragm here is very important, because what has to happen through the diaphragm? It has to be, it has to stop the gas from going from one side to the other side, and then at the same time, it has to act as an electrolyte. Everybody's familiar with the sulfuric acid that's inside of your car battery. It's the exact same thing here. It has to be able to allow that charge, that current, to travel through the battery. Keep that in mind. It has to keep the hydrogen and oxygen separate from each other. It has to allow the ions to move across. Those are the most important things. So what is PEM electrolysis? The electrolyte solution, before we had it, could have been any type of a salt. It could have been a sodium chloride, it could have been sodium hydroxide, anything like that. But we get rid of the salt solution, we replace it with a solid. And what they do is they take a polymer molecule, which is a long, long chain, and they attach the acid onto it. So now you have something that's an acid. At the same time, it's a solid. And so this has many advantages. First of all, it doesn't spill like sulfuric acid. I can hold it. It can be very, very strong, and I can hold it. It's not dangerous at all. But most importantly for this application, it's a solid. It's a piece of plastic. It's a solid. So it makes the hydrogen, it makes the oxygen. The oxygen naturally stays on one side, the hydrogen naturally stays on the other side. Very important for this is you can now have a difference in pressure from one side to the other side. My company makes electrolyzers for the Navy that they put inside of the submarines. The submarines will go underwater for months at a time, and the submariners need something to breathe. So the a nuclear submarine has all the energy in the world. Has a nuclear power plant on board. They obviously have all the water that they need, but they need the oxygen. So they make the oxygen, and the oxygen will come off of one side of the membrane here. The oxygen is being made here, and that goes right into the submarine just at the pressure that we're breathing. Now the hydrogen on the other side, on the other hand, it comes off at almost 1,000 psi. So you have a thin piece of plastic right here, and you have the hydrogen coming off at 1,000 psi because you want to store that hydrogen. You can't bubble it behind you, or you say hello, here we are. So you store the hydrogen. In fact, you use it to help scrub the CO2 as well. But you could obviously only do that with a solid. So that's PEM electrolysis. More of you might be more familiar with PEM fuel cell. There's a lot of excitement. I hope there's a lot of excitement about fuel cell vehicles. And it's the fuel cell vehicle is a PEM vehicle. It does this, but the direct opposite. Now you pump the hydrogen and the oxygen into the fuel cell and you get the electricity out of it. So it's the exact same thing, but just like a battery is rechargeable, the fuel cell and electrolyzer can be rechargeable as well. When you're charging, the hydrogen and oxygen come off, and when you're using it, you feed the hydrogen and oxygen into it in order to get the electricity. So where are we using these things today? Okay, they're actually being used in a lot of places. We can get our electricity from the grid itself, from wind or from solar or other renewables, and that feeds our electrolyzer. The hydrogen that comes from the electrolyzer can go to storage, and then of course it can go to the fuel cell to get our power later. We can use it to power a fuel cell vehicle. Of course, there are the storage tanks right there in the back of the vehicle. And everybody says, isn't it dangerous to have a fuel cell vehicle with all of the compressed hydrogen? Anybody that's seen a gasoline automobile explode, yeah, it can happen. And hydrogen, yeah, it can happen. A battery, people have probably seen the fires that have been started from the Tesla types of batteries. Yeah, it can happen. Anytime you're going to take enough energy to move 3,000 or 4,000 pounds of steel 300 miles, it's going to be dangerous because that's just a lot of energy in a small amount of area. So it doesn't matter if you're storing it by hydrogen or gas or by battery, it's always going to be dangerous. Another thing that we're doing with the hydrogen as well, there's a lot of interest in biogas right now. People, they take the farm waste and they throw it in a vat with bacteria, and it makes carbon dioxide and methane. Of course, we'd rather it just produce the methane alone. And so if you feed the biogas plant hydrogen as well, instead of producing the methane, which you can use as natural gas, and CO2, it just produces methane. So this is actually Giner's, their first very large, we're talking a megawatt scale, which is about the amount of energy that's being used maybe by this whole campus right now, is going to be used to serve that application. So lots of ways that we can do it. Okay, the cost of electrolysis is becoming more and more competitive. So how much does a kilogram with hydrogen? We usually measure it in terms of a kilogram. A kilogram of hydrogen, but that's kind of hard to wrap your head around. But thermodynamics kind of shine kindly upon us here, and that the energy in a kilogram of hydrogen is almost exactly the amount of energy in a gallon of gasoline. So people quite often talk about a gallon of gasoline equivalent and how much that costs. Currently, right now, for the cost of electrolysis, we're at about $5 a kilogram. And I don't have to convince too many people that, the cost of gas is pretty close to that already. The other thing I want to show you is that, the largest cost for hydrogen right now comes from the power. So there's two things you have to do then You either have to use the power when it's very cheap in the middle of the night, when the windmills are spinning and nobody wants it. So that's a fantastic opportunity. And the other thing you have to do is make sure your electrolyzer is as efficient as possible. And that's what I've been spending most of my career doing, is trying to make, is trying to get that cost down as low as possible. Now, what I always hate about the comparison for people, I always compare about the price for a gallon of gasoline equivalent, is that when we use hydrogen, we use it much more efficiently than we do gasoline. For instance, I've gotten to drive a number of fuel cell vehicles, and the General Motors, their Equinox vehicle. Of course, they have their gasoline version, but they also did a fuel cell version as well. And it got just over 50 miles per kilogram of hydrogen, whereas, of course, from gasoline, it only got about 30. So the true, in my mind, the true gallon of gasoline equivalent, you have to take the fact that the fuel cell is much more efficient than an internal combustion engine when you make that comparison, okay? All right, so just another example here as well, and I won't delve on it too much, but what I'm looking at here is if you're looking at the economics of a windmill. So here we have a typical windmill farm will be 100 megawatts, which is about a dozen of the very, very large windmills. And the windmill itself, it costs about $1,000 a kilowatt. Now I did this analysis a couple of years ago, and the storage system here is about $500 a kilowatt for the electrolyzer and $500 a kilowatt for the fuel cell. Right now, the automotive manufacturers, their goal is about $50 a kilowatt for the fuel cell. So they're already way, way, way below that for automotive fuel cells. It's pretty amazing. If you think about it, the Equinox that I drove has about an 80 kilowatt power plant on board for the fuel cell. So that's about at $50, that'll be about $4,000 for the power plant. And I was like, oh, hey, the actual price now are about $100 a kilowatt. And so you think, well, that's not terrible. That means that the fuel cell and stuff is only $8,000. That should be doable, right, for a car. And then you talk to the automobile people, and the thing you don't realize is that for a typical, Honda Accord, the engine and the transmission and everything in between cost under $3,000, about $2,500. So it just boggles my mind that's about what it costs them to produce. So $100 a kilowatt doesn't do it for automotive, but $50 will do it. Okay, so then you have your maintenance and such there. So if you only have the windmill, this is the cost of your windmill. This is the cost of operating it over 20 years. And this is when you go to sell your electricity to the utility company and you start to haggle over price, they say, well, when are you going to give me the energy? And you go, I don't know. And they go, well, how much are you going to give me? I don't know. Well, that electricity isn't worth very much to them because they don't know when they're going to get it. In fact, they hate it. And they usually only take it because they have to. And they assign a very low value for that. So you're only getting, you're saying, oh, these people in Massachusetts are paying 15 cents a kilowatt hour for their electricity, but I'm only getting 3 cents a kilowatt hour because the utilities, I mean, think if you had a car and you never had any idea when it was going to work. I drove this car. You never had any idea when it was going to work or how far it was going to go. It wouldn't be very valuable for you, right? Let's say you now hook up your windmill with one of our regenerative systems. Of course, you have a higher cost at the beginning because you have an extra component. But now, for that energy that you store, the power companies go, oh, if I can have that anytime when I tell you I want it, I can have it. That's incredibly valuable for them, because that date on August 13th when it hits 103 degrees and they need that peak amount of energy. If you think about it, it's something that really threw me for a curve. If you think of the infrastructure that exists for our energy, we build the whole thing for that peak day on August 13th. So you have to have a power plant out there that's only operating for, you know, one day a year, or you have to have all that capacity. So if you can provide the power company that capacity for just the peaks, that energy is incredibly valuable to them because they don't need to build another power plant in order to cover that. So that energy is very valuable. So if you do all of that, you know, we're actually making money. So we can do that. But what happens if our system is only 40% efficient? We take all that electricity, we generate our hydrogen and oxygen, and then we take the hydrogen and oxygen, we take it back to get our electricity, and we only get 40% of the electricity that we started with. You see, now our windmill that was making money is now losing money. So again, the most important things are to get the efficiency of that electrolyzer as high as possible, while getting the cost down as low as possible as well. Okay, this does a very good job of showing the costs of storing energy by the ways that we've talked about. Again, the two that electrolysis can't really compete against are pumped hydro. This is the gold standard. I mean, there's nothing as reliable, nothing as cheap, nothing as efficient as pumped hydro, but you can only do it so many places. And the other, of course, is the compressed air storages, but those only increase the efficiency of natural gas power plants that already exist. Everything else is here, and using a fuel cell or an electrolyzer with either a fuel cell or a turbine is actually the next cheapest thing that we can do. I spent most of my life looking at these curves, so they're second nature to me, so I hope I can do a good job explaining them. When you have a battery, most of the batteries that you operate at 1.5 volts. That's how hard the electrons are pouring to spin around to the other side of the battery, okay? But what we never think about is that when we bring more electrons, or when we operate at a higher current level, one thing we don't think about is that voltage starts to drop. At 1.5 volts, to get more electrons to go through it, it might drop down to 1.4 volts, or 1.3 volts, or 1.2 volts, depending on how far you push it. It's the exact same thing with electrolysis. You put a voltage across the electrolyzer, and you'll get a certain amount of current through it. If you want more current and more energy, you have to put a higher voltage across it. Well, this is where our electrolyzer can theoretically start to make hydrogen and oxygen at 1.23 volts, okay? But there's a lot of things that slow it down from occurring perfectly. There's resistance for the electrons themselves. There's no wire that is resistance-free. There's no electrode or package that has no resistance. So we have all those electrical resistances. The membrane resistance right here, remember we talked about the solid polymer earlier, all of the acid protons or acid groups have to move from one side of the membrane to the other side of the membrane, and that takes energy as well. So you lose more and more of that energy as you increase the current. And then there is a thing I have here, it's called kinetic overpotential. The oxygen does not want to come off. It's very difficult to break the bonds of hydrogen and oxygen, and that's a very slow reaction. And the only way to speed it up is to put more energy into it, okay? So all of this is wasted energy. When we're talking about the round-trip efficiency before, this is the stuff we're trying to eliminate. So here's our voltage versus our current curve here, and this is what it looks like for an electrolyzer. And it's the direct opposite. There's a mirror right here. It's the direct opposite when it's operating as a fuel cell. So here's where we're drawing the current out of our battery. As you draw more and more current out of there, the efficiency, the voltage, goes lower and lower. On the electrolyzer side of things, as we're putting a higher voltage into there, the current goes higher and higher. So you can see at the very low current, your efficiency is quite simply your fuel cell voltage divided by your electrolyzer voltage, okay? So here, at very low current density, you can see your efficiency is pretty good, right? But you go up in current here, now your voltage here is very low, and your electrolyzer voltage here is very high. So if you divide your fuel cell voltage by your electrolyzer voltage, that's a miserable efficiency, okay? So you say, well, why don't we just operate here the whole time? Well, if we operate right here, say we call we just give this an arbitrary unit of 1. And we operate over here, we give this an arbitrary unit of 10. The one that we operate here is 1/10 the size of the one here. It's 10 times cheaper to operate out here than it is to operate over here. So you want to operate here because this is where it's economically viable. In fact, for our electrolyzers right now, for the longest time, they operated right around 1 amp per centimeter squared. So if people aren't, if you're not around electricity, it's kind of hard to get a gasp of that. But the most current that can come out of your wall socket is 20 amps. And so here's, it's 1 square centimeter, and normally those operate on 1 amp per centimeter squared. But now the electrolyzer we're doing now can operate between 5 to 10 amps per centimeter squared. So again, if you think of the reaction happening that quickly, so in just one little square centimeter. Okay, so how can we, all right, okay, I understand we want to operate here and have these as close as possible. So what can we do to get those two curves closer to each other, okay? Well, the one thing we can do is increase the amount of catalyst that we put here. Here, this is the oxygen side, and this is the hydrogen side, okay? So the hydrogen reaction is incredibly quick. Nobody has even really been able to measure how fast hydrogen reacts on a piece of platinum. It's so quick that we don't lose any efficiency to this reaction at all. It's all on the oxygen side. And so we can increase the catalyst, and what does that do? Ooh, that's good. It brings both of these down. There's more. We talked about the over potential on the other side. There's more catalyst there. So we decrease that. Can we add even more? Yes. We can add more, but there's a law of diminishing returns. It's a logarithmic type of a function, so to get the same type of a boost, you have to have 10 times as much catalyst. This is platinum, it's not cheap. I've worked on a number of NASA and military programs. They don't care how much platinum. They'll pay whatever it takes to get that little tiny bit of a boost, but for automotive, when I started with automotive, and when I started in fuel cells about 20 years ago, the amount of platinum that it took for an automotive engine was about the equivalent of 100 to 200 catalytic converters. And you look at that, you're like, oh gosh, catalytic converters are already $200. That's $20,000 just for the catalyst cost. Now they're down to about 5 or 10. And now it's, oh wow, for 5 or 10, yeah, it suddenly becomes real. A catalytic converter isn't the most expensive thing in the car, and if that's all the platinum it takes. So anyway, so you can only add so much catalyst, right? All right, we talked about the acid groups here that are attached to the polymer, and they're what's moving the charge back and forth across the membrane. So one thing we can do is add more acid to the membrane, right? What does that do? Ooh, that's good. It now turns these and it brings them right up. Hey, now we can operate at a higher efficiency way out here, all right? What else can we do? Can we make it even thinner? Okay, we can do that. Oh, hey, it's even better, right? But there's a penalty as well. Of course, not everything comes for free, of course. These, when I first started working in fuel cells, 20 years ago, a 5 mil membrane, which is a couple pieces of paper together, was a thin membrane. Now we're down to about 18 microns, which is it's smaller than the really cheap plastic bag you get from Target. It's thinner than that. And that's what we're using to keep the hydrogen at high pressure on one side and the oxygen at low pressure on the other side. And that becomes very difficult to do. So both of these things make the membrane incredibly weak. It's the chain part of the polymer that gives the polymer its strength. And now you start adding something to it, the polymer chain can't come together and crystallize and give itself more and more strength because these acid groups are getting in the way. And in fact, you add too many of these, it actually becomes soluble in water and completely falls apart. Okay, and now it's thinner as well, so you add more acid, you go thinner, and everything is becoming weaker and weaker. So one of the things that I spent a lot of time, and I've gotten a lot of money from the Department of Energy and from General Motors to do, is to add a support here. Now, that anybody in this room could have thought of that. Well, it's getting small, we'll just throw something in there that's strong as a support. And so, it doesn't take a lot of genius, but I've probably gotten about, at least $10 million in funding just for that idea. So, you know, it doesn't take, you know, it's just, anyone could have done that, right? One of the other things that's really bad about the membrane is for electrolysis, we want to produce the gases at a very high pressure. Now, this is a little bit difficult. Again, here's the current density here. This is how much energy it takes to create a kilogram of hydrogen. So you have a very thick membrane and it operates very efficiently. You can't go to very high current density because now you've made it very thick and those protons have to travel all the way from one side to the other side. And so it's not very efficient at high currents. You can go to a very thin membrane here and you're wondering how come the thin membrane doesn't have a very high efficiency. Well, here we're producing the hydrogen and oxygen at 1,000 psi so we can store it. And you have a thin membrane like that, the gases permeate across the membrane. So they go and they're lost. So you can't go too thin. So one of the things that we're really trying to do is to decrease the permeability of the membrane. So if we can do that, the very important thing, if we can improve that polymer to give us a much lower permeability, what allows us to do is not only decrease the energy requirement, but it allows us to go up and down in how fast we operate. We can operate very efficient over a large range. And again, we're talking about you're going, if you're hooked up to a solar panel on a partly cloudy day or a windmill where the wind is changing, you want to be able to take all that energy up and down and up and down. So this is one of the other big challenges that we're working on. Another way to increase the efficiency, as you saw on the slide before, is to increase the temperature. Right now, most electrolyzers operate at around 60 degrees C. We're working now, we have ones that operate at 80 degrees C. You can see how that lowers the voltage and the amount of energy required. And we're working on ones that'll hopefully operate at 100 degrees C. So again, that has a big improvement of current. Okay, how can we lower the cost? This is the cost of an electrolyzer system right here. This is the cost of the electrolyzer stack. And oh yeah, this is the power supply. So the rectifier that takes the electricity, however it comes, and makes it so that the electrolyzer can accept it. And this is the balance of plant. All the pumps and the water cleaners and all of that kind of stuff. So by far the most expensive thing is the stack. And of the stack, one of the most expensive things is the separators and the MEA. And these two things have platinum and iridium inside of them. And that's what makes them expensive. How can we lower the cost of the iridium? This is a project we're doing with 3M. 3M has these amazing little thing. It looks exactly like carpet, right? But the each one of these is each one of these fibers is the size of is about 20 to 50 nanometers across. That's you have to put a dozen of those across each other to be the same size as the wavelength of light. You know, if you think of it in that terms. So they take those fibers and they put almost a single layer of platinum or iridium over the course of one of those fibers. Because if you think about it, if you have a precious metal and you're trying to make it as thin as possible, get as much surface area, as much active area out of that metal as you can, you want to make it thinner and thinner and thinner, because if you have a big chunk of metal, obviously the metal in the middle is not doing anything. It's not doing any work. It's only the surface metal that's doing any work. So here's a way that they were able to do that. And we're starting to get very similar performance. Again, if you go back a dozen years or so, the amount of catalyst that was being used was between 4 to 8 milligrams per centimeter squared. Now we're down to about 1 milligram per centimeter squared, and this could take it down to another order of magnitude lower. So what does an actual electrolyzer look like? Very similar to a battery, you have to take those individual cells and pile them on top of each other. So here is one of our cells. This is very similar and looks very similar to the electrolyzer that's inside of a nuclear submarine. You have the MEA that we talked about, you know, that thin membrane with the catalyst on the two sides, and then you have to support it. You're gonna have, it's gonna be a high pressure on both sides. So if you think of if you had a piece of saran wrap, okay, and if you had a, if you were gonna put 1,000 PSI on one side of it, you know, if you think about it, you know, that'd be somebody my weight on a finger pushing on it. If you support that with a porous screen, it's gonna go right through. So now if you supported it with a piece of granite, nothing would happen at all. It's got nowhere to go. But in order for the bubbles to come out of the electrolyzer, it has to be porous, of course. So making materials that can support a very thin membrane, but let the gases come out is a tricky part of the business. So we build stacks up there. Sometimes if the pressure is very, very high, we take the stack and we put it inside of a pressure container. That way the gases aren't trying to escape on the outside, because we filled the outside with high pressure. So for the part count we're required to generate, this is 10 normal meters cubed per hour of hydrogen. You think of a meter cubed as that. Back in 2006, this is where we were. That stack there would be about 6,000 parts, and we're down here now where it's just a couple hundred parts. So, and that, even more than the material, the cost of the platinum, the cost of the iridium and the titanium, that lowers the cost more than anything. That's it. Those are the challenges and the things that I'm working on. You know, hope I've convinced you that you know, renewables, they are playing a larger part, and I think they need to continue. And, you know, I think that the only way that we can take it above, say, 20 or 30% of our electricity needs is to store it. And I think one of the only ways to store it practically on a large scale is through electrolysis. There are still a lot of challenges in improving electrolysis, and you know, I think it's a great job. That's what I do. Thanks.